by Stephanie to let you know that after this session at 6 o'clock, there's going to be a talk by Tom Ball of Microsoft in this plenary area for half an hour about work going on at Microsoft Research. And then at 6:30, there's a Microsoft-sponsored reception. Anyhow, this is the last session of refereed talks about session types. And I'm delighted to introduce three talks on session types this afternoon. And the first one is going to be, all three in fact, are co-authored by Nobuko Yoshida. So it's a bit of a Nobuko session, as it were. And this one is going to be delivered by Bernardo Tonino.
Yes.
Over to you.
Everyone can hear me fine? Okay. So I'll start by essentially trying to define what all those keywords mean in the title, because a lot of you won't be really familiar with these terms. So the title says, session-based logical processes. I'll try to define what we mean by session-based processes and also session-based logical processes. So I'll start with multi-party session processes, which you'll hear about a lot in this session. So when we talk about multi-party session types, I like to think of it as a multi-party session framework, not just a simple typing discipline, as you'll see. And so the idea there is that you have some notion of multi-party types, which type processes in a specialized pi calculus, essentially. And the idea there, and why I think of it as more of a framework, is that so the goal is to have types that describe interactions between an arbitrary number of participants. And the way this works is you have some concept of a global type, which I'll show you in a few slides, which provides you sort of a bird's eye view, a global view of a communication protocol. And then you have local types, which are assigned to processes, which essentially give you the localized view, so a participant's view, their contribution to a protocol. And the idea is that if you have this entire setup in the right way, global types give you a notion of progress within this collection of interacting agents. Okay, so that's multi-party, which we'll call MP from now on. So logic-based processes, so these are the ones that come from the propositions as types, correspondence between session types and linear logic. And I'm going to be using the classical variant. And so the idea is that session types can be seen as linear logic propositions. And by session types here, I mean so-called binary session types. So the idea is that a type describes an interaction between two agents. Okay. And so the processes, which are a session pi calculus, so again, a specialized pi calculus, can be seen as proof terms for this linear logic. And the way this works, which is, as we'll see, somewhat simpler than the multi-party setting, is that every process pair, essentially, shares one communication channel that is compatible in sort of both endpoints. And because of this, you get very nice, strong, and compositional properties, or you can establish this compositionally, deadlock-freedom, strong normalization, and other things. Okay. So what about the interconnectability stuff? So this is terminology that we borrowed from a now quite old paper by Abramsky and others. So this is actually a global type from multiparty. So this describes an interaction between three agents, if you will, so P, Q, and R. And this just says P sends to Q a natural number, P sends to R a Boolean, and R sends to Q a string, okay? So if you think of this as a network, right, you'll have three agents, right, P, Q, and R. And if you think about how these agents are connected, well, certainly if you look at the type, right? So P is connected to Q, certainly. P is connected to R for sure, and R is connected to Q. So you have this sort of triangle-looking thing. So if you try to realize this in the sort of logical binary setting, for those of you that know how this works, you'll be very familiar with what I'm about to show you. But, well, essentially, you can connect these three processes, if you will, in this way. Because essentially you say, okay, I'm going to connect P with Q, they share a channel now. I connect P and R and they share a channel, but I can't really connect Q and R simultaneously because they can only share one channel, okay? Essentially this process can only share with this process one channel. So you can connect them this way or any of these ways, but not like that, okay? In fact, another way you can think of this or a way you can realize this is as a you add a new role, essentially a new process, which acts as a mediator between these three agents. And this is work by Kaidis, Perez, and many others now. So you can do it this way as well. But so what we tried to do in this work is try to figure out in what precise sense do these kind of things generalize these kinds of things, essentially. Okay. So the sort of one slide version of our contributions. So we have a negative result, which seems somewhat obvious, I think, which is that if you take the classical process that I showed you, well, they cannot really represent the general multiparty networks. This is just the intuition from the previous slide. On the bright side is that you can take a single multiparty session, and you can represent all the networks that you could represent in the logical setting, which is nice. And perhaps nicer is that you can use the multiparty framework, as we'll see, to augment the kind of networks that you can build using the logical setting. Okay, so what did we do? So we tried to develop this sort of framework to study this notion of interconnection networks between these logical processes and multiparty processes, so session processes, essentially. So it's kind of a new way of measuring expressiveness. And along the way, we developed this compositional global type synthesis, which I'll tell you about, that allows us to study what these networks mean in the logical setting and how we can augment them. Okay. So, multiparty session processes in one slide without typing rules. So that process Q up there, this is a pi calculus looking process, but it doesn't really look like the pi calculus in the traditional sense. So the idea here is that this big Q is the implementation of the Q process from here, okay, from below there. So the way you should read this is that this is a session, a multiparty session S, and this is the implementation of the process that plays the role of little q. Okay, so this is on this session, little q is communicating with p, and q is communicating with r, and q is communicating with p. So this is q sending to p a number, q receiving from r something and binding it to z, and q sending to p hello. Okay, so that's a process. This is the implementation for the role little p, which I'm going to use as big P. So it's kind of the same idea. So P talks to Q and to R and then to Q again. And this could be an implementation for R. So R talks to Q and P, and this is essentially this part of the triangle. So how does this work in terms of typing? So this is what a local type would look like, okay? So it just describes, so this would be the typing for the process Q, and this just says, well, Q, the way the sub-channel, if you will, for Q, works is, well, it's going to send to P, receive from R, and send to P. So just the part that corresponds to Q. And you can do that for P, and you can do that for R in the sort of kind of obvious, I think, way. And you can compose these three things. So these T1 to T2 and T3 would be these three types. You can compose them in parallel, which is fine. But the important thing is that if you want to close out the session, because the idea here is that this is a three-party session. I have all the processes. Now I want to sort of hide this session, close it so it can run, if you think of it in those terms. You can only do this step, which is I am done with this session, so to speak, if you have a global type of the previous slides. So what this means is that you can view this in one of two ways. Either you start out with these local types, okay, and you synthesize from them a global type. So this is a well-established theory by now, developed by Nobuko and others. And if you can do that, you can't always do that, but if you can do that, then the resulting system will be deadlock-free. The more traditional direction, if you will, is you project. So you take the global type, you start from the global type, you project from the global type the various local types that would be written there. And if you can do that, because not always you can do it, you get deadlock freedom. Okay? But you need everyone, right? You need all the processes in one go, which is kind of crucial. Okay, so what I'm going to show you now in the time I have left is what we did, how to connect the logical processes, which I haven't shown you yet, with the multi-party session channels that I've showed you in a previous slide. So the idea is that we're going to treat each thread, if you will, as the implementation of a single multi-party role, so one of those P, Q, and Rs from before. And distinct channels in the logical world will map essentially to distinct roles. And we're going to also have a way to infer a local type looking at the process actions, essentially. Then we're going to come up with a way to synthesize global types and these kind of network graphs, if you will, in a compositional way, which is quite important. And we're going to analyze the limitations of the networks, and we're going to use this synthesis to augment them. Okay, so how does this work? So I won't really show you the typing rules for logical processes. They're the typing rules of linear logic, more or less. But essentially, this would read something like P is using the sessions that are described in that typing context delta, essentially, in the way prescribed by the communication, by the session types. So what we have is a translation, associated with the typing, that can map logical channels to role-based MP channels. And we have a specialized way to handle composition of processes and these mappings, or translations. So we also have a way to generate local types. And instead of showing you definitions, which would be a bit boring, I'm just going to show you a quick example. So this would be a logical process, It's a bit different from the ones from before, but kind of related. So the idea is that it has two communication channels, X and Y. So this, in this case, is going to send on X7, receive on Y, and then send on X, And one possible way of mapping, let's say, translating this process to the multiparty thing would be this way, So essentially, we're going to identify the channel X as the subchannel between P and Q, which is what we do here, and we're going to identify Y as the subchannel between P and R, So we can do that, and we can infer from this in a sort of obvious way the local typing. And there are, of course, some side conditions that are needed for this to work, but I'm blurring through that for now. So if you were to take a process R, that just sort of has the dual action, so the send that corresponds to that receive, you could map it in this way, And indeed, in the logical setting, you're free to compose these two processes, P and R, and we define essentially how to compose the mappings or when it's safe to compose the mappings. So this process R maps to this session process, implementation of R, and essentially, roughly, because the actions are dual in the multiparty sense, so the receive matches with the send, you're good to go, essentially. And you can plug them together nicely. Okay, so what does this sort of very high-level notion of a mapping have? So because it's a very simple form of mapping, it sort of straightforwardly preserves types, which is kind of expected. It doesn't really affect the operational behavior of processes, which is kind of also expected. But the key thing, or the sort of thing that we were looking for, is this idea of preserving threads, So the idea is that a cut-free, a composition, parallel composition-free logical process is going to map to a single multiparty role always by construction. And what turns out is that the way in which we define the mapping, the conditions that our mappings must satisfy are such that all thread-preserving typable mappings are sort of captured by our definition, So in some sense, there's some canonicity to what we did. And this is fine, but how do we get global types, networks, and from this? So again, mostly intuitions due to time constraints. But the idea, which is a bit of a tongue twister, is to come up with a notion of a partial global type, What does that mean? So we're going to look at a role's contribution to the global session, but from the process or local type perspective, But the neat thing is the compositional aspect of this, because synthesis or global type synthesis is not really compositional in the existing literature. You need to have all the local types, and then from that you synthesize one global type in one go. Here we're going to do this compositionally, so one at a time, if you will. So we're going to come up with a way to combine or fuse partial global types, which is only defined when it works out, if you will, when it's safe, when there are no deadlocks implied by the communication. So again, an example. So this would be the local type for the process from the few slides ago. And the global, or the partial global type for it, now has a bunch of squiggly arrows. What do the squiggly arrows mean? Well, this has communication between P and Q, and between R and P, and between P and Q, but only half, if you will, of the communication, So only the sending half of this communication, or the receiving half. And if you look at the partial type, let's say, for R, well, it's just this squiggly arrow between R and P. And if you try to fuse these two, it turns out that the resulting partial type is one where you still have squiggly arrows, but the actions that match here make this arrow sort of full, complete, okay? And so, and we can define this in such a way that this works safely. And the global type induces the kind of network graph that I showed you a few slides ago, more or less in the expected way where things are connected when the arrows are there. So putting it all together. So we have a logical process. It's typed. We can map it into the multi-party setting using a mapping. We can infer or synthesize the local and the partial types, okay, using these two functions that rely on the mapping. We can compose the processes and mappings in a consistent way. And we can also compose these partial types in a consistent way using the fuse, okay? And the results would be, well, essentially the ones that I showed you many slides ago now, which is if the process is closed, essentially all the sessions are sort of localized. Well, the resulting generated and fused up global type is unique up to some notion of permutation and complete, no leftover actions to be done, okay? And there are no triangles, no cycles of the kind of form that I alluded to before, so the network is acyclic in that sense. And that's where the a single multiparty session is enough to represent the interleavings of logical sessions. And we cannot represent the general cyclic-looking networks from multiparty in the logical setting. So this also scales with some caveats to replication, which I didn't show you, and delegation, which I also didn't show you for sanity reasons. But this is fine, but I also promised to sort of go a bit beyond the sort of acyclic networks. So the reason why you really don't want to write or general and unrestricted, let's say, cyclic networks would be because you want to avoid deadlocks, and of course this configuration here is a cycle, so essentially, or a potential cycle in this case. And of course, if you can write these things, you can write now deadlock stuck processes because you have essentially a send on X and a send on Y composed with a receive on Y and the receive on X. So the order of the actions doesn't match, so the process is stuck. No room to move. And so this is disallowed by composition. Because composition in the logical setting looks like this. I didn't really show you typing rules before. But the idea is that you have two processes. You want to plug them together in parallel. They share one channel, this X here. And they're typed with the dual type, so compatible type, sends map to receives and things like that. And they share just this one channel, and they're only allowed to share this one channel. All the other channels in delta and delta prime are disjoint, and that's why you cannot write cycles, right? And you don't get deadlocks. But the kind of fusion that we defined before means that the induced processes, types, etc., are all safe, so cannot result in deadlocks. So maybe we can use that in this kind of configuration, this kind of composition. So what we did is, well, take a process that has, a bunch of channels, okay. If you have a mapping for that, and you take another process, and you have a mapping for that, and the sort of the channels match in the expected way, so sends map to receive, match with receives, well, generate the global type from that, so fuse them, generate the global types, and then fuse it all up. So you have G1, G2, well, if the fuse operation is defined, so if they're fusible, the resulting system has to be safe, has to be deadlock-free by design, if you will. And so this is a so-called multi-cut rule, okay? And there are things missing here that I'm not showing you because this is quite subtle, in fact. But essentially, you can come up with a process, a mapping, a process, and a mapping, look at the global types. If they're fusible, then even though they share many, many sessions, potentially, the resulting thing will be deadlock-free anyway. So this is a so-called multi-cut rule of logic. And that's basically it. So what we did was I tried to sort of introduce this framework for expressiveness of processes using interconnectability, and there are many other approaches about sort of cycles in these kinds of works. And so thank you for your time. I'll take questions.
We'll start with a question from Slido.
Yeah.
The question is about your choice of using classical linear logic rather than, say, intuitionistic
yes.
linear logic in the results.
So, with the So the way I told this story is I sort of led you down this path, right? Where at the end I told you, okay, we can also use this to look at how to extend the networks, right? But that was kind of, in the way we started working on this, was that was kind of our goal to begin with. And the thing is, it's not, it seems a bit more natural to write a rule that looks like this, okay, in the sort of classical system of processes. So that's, in fact, one of the main motivations to start out from the classical setting. Although the most of these results, I guess the definitions have to be extremely adjusted, but the results themselves are not intrinsic to the classical setting, the results before this slide, essentially. But because the way I told the story, it looks like I led you down this path, and so essentially that's my answer.
Okay. Do we have any questions from the floor? If you want to come up, you can use the mic.
Sam?
Does this work kind of map back onto linear logic in the sense of, can you use it to do proofs in a different way somehow?
Proofs in the
It change the linear logic?
Well, certainly this is extremely different from what you'd expect, right? So, of course, so this is kind of in the spirit of Simon and Ornella's work, right? The thing is that because this definition is quite more, let's say, semantic than theirs, it's kind of hard to pinpoint what this does exactly to proof. So we haven't studied that aspect of it so far. We sort of looked at what happens with processes, not so much looking at the logical side. But that's something to look at. Yeah.
I have a question. In a piece of work like this, where you're showing equivalence or showing translations between two systems, I mean, often the insights have implications elsewhere. And I wonder in the constructions or in the proofs you've done here, you think this particular aspects that might be applicable in other situations?
Other situations? So that's a very general question, but kind of a hard one, because the way this is set up, there is, of course, I didn't show you a lot of detail because I can't, but this is set up to allow us to study session processes. And in principle, this our framework, because the way we built it up, we started off with a very small fragment like the one I showed you here, and we built it up to add more constructs, essentially. So it does seem that we can extend our system to handle sort of the typical kinds of processes that are session typeable, let's say. Beyond session types, it's who knows, but let's look at that. But the reality is that there are a lot of session typing systems, and it seems that we can handle the kinds of things that people usually do with session typing systems. So that in itself is kind of a lot in some sense, but more than that would be nice to look at as well.
Okay, I think we're out of time. Thanks. Let's thank the speaker again.